Chapter 9. Heir Apparent. From this moment dates my official title of Liliuokalani, that being the name under which I was formally proclaimed princess and heir apparent to the throne of my ancestors. Now that this important matter had been decided by those whom the Constitution invests with that prerogative, it became proper and necessary for me to make a tour of the islands to meet the people, that all classes, rich and poor, planter or fishermen, might have an opportunity to become somewhat acquainted with the one who some day should be called to hold the highest executive office. The first journey undertaken was that of encircling the island on which the capital city of Honolulu is situated. We therefore started from our home to make the trip around the coastline of Oahu, a tour of nearly 150 miles, following the roads which wind along on the brink of the ocean. This we proposed to do on horseback, although my carriage, when I could rest if required, accompanied the party. Our cavalcade was a large one, my immediate companions being my husband, General Dominus, governor of the island, and my sister, the Princess Liliuokalani, wife of Hon Claghorn, who was attended by her personal suite. But large numbers are not discouragement to Hawaiian hospitality, especially under the additional inspiration of the love and loyalty to their chiefs. So the people open their doors with an aloha, nui loa to us in words and acts, and wherever we want a grand reception awaited us on arrival. Our route was first to the eastward, past Diamond Head, Cocoa Head, to the point of Macapua, then turning to the northward and around to Waimanola, where we found ourselves the guests of Akua, a very wealthy Chinaman who owned a large plantation there devoted to the cultivation of rice. Intelligence of our approach must have travelled faster than we had ridden, for as soon as our cavalcade drew near to this estate, we were greeted with a discharge of firecrackers and bombs, led off to the honour to the presence of the heir to the throne and her companions. There was no cessation of the salutes during the feast of good things which had been spread by Akau for our refreshment, to which and to the professions of loyalty on the part of our host we did ample justice. From thence we proceeded to Monawili, the beautiful residence of Mr. and Mrs. Boyd, whose door were already opened for our reception. And here we spent the night and remained an entire day, enjoying the entertainment prepared for us, which can be described in no better terms than by saying that we received a royal welcome indeed. Our progress continued on the day following through Kanoe, our noonday rest being at the house of Judge B, where a generous lunch awaited us on the moment of our arrival. The people of that entire district had congregated to do us honor and showed us in every way that there was no doubt of disloyalty in their hearts. Yet, while still at Kanoa, a letter was received by the Princess Liliuokalani from her husband, in which that gentleman advised his wife to return to Honolulu, and stated it was his opinion that if it was the purpose of my tour to meet the people and cultivate their love, the time spent on the route would be wasted because they were all zealous partisans of Queen Emma. My sister acquainted me with these views of her husband and asked my advice as to her cause. I did not wish to influence her in any way, and therefore left it to her option to continue the journey with me or to take Mr. Claghorn's advice. But we had already advanced far enough on our pathway amongst the people to prove that her husband had made a great mistake, for no heir to the throne could have been more royally received by all than I had been. The princess had not failed to notice this, and as we proceeded, it was still more apparent. The most zealous of Queen Emma's people, now that the question had been officially decided, hastened to do us honor. So, after due consideration, Princess Liliuokalani decided that she would not return, a decision she had no after occasion to regret, and was one of which made me very glad, for she was welcomed and showered with marks of favor by the very adherents of Queen Emma, of whose disappointment she had been warned by her husband. It would be tiresome to others, perhaps, should I go on and describe with minute particulars the steps of our party as they passed around the island. From place to place, the reception was the same, cheerful, hearty, and enthusiastic. Kahuku, Waialua, Makahoa, Waiane, and so on, to our latest stopping place, which was with Mr. James Campbell and his sweet wife at Honoululi. We had the advantage of a little more time in his preparations for our reception than was possible to some of our other places of rest, and had spared no pains to give us an ovation in every way worthy of himself and his amiable companion. The result was a manifestation of kind feelings and generous hospitality such as even at this distant day cannot know nor ever will be effaced from my memory. From thence we started for Honolulu, and as it was noised abroad that the party would enter the city, there was scarcely space for our cavalcade to pass between the throngs of people which lined our way. From Leleo to Alakea Street, it was a mass of moving heads, through which only slowly could our carriage, horses, and outriders pass. It was understood and accepted as a victorious procession, and out of sympathy for the disappointed Dowager Queen, our people refrained from noisy demonstration and loud cheering, and instead the men removed their hats and the women saluted as we passed. I have been thus careful in reviewing this my first trip as heir to the throne, both because it's a pleasure to recall the memory of that epoch in my life, and further that I may speak with pride of the continued affection of the unshaken love of these my people. In some nations, the leaders, the chief rulers, have gone forth through districts conquered by the sword and compelled the people to show their subjection. Our progress from beginning to end was a triumphal march, and might well be described as that awarded to victors. But there were no dying nor wounded mortals in our track. We had vanquished the hearts of the people. They showed us their love. They welcomed me as Hawaiians always have the ruling chief, and to this day, without the slightest appeal on my part, they have shown that their love and loyalty to our family in general and to myself in particular have known no chance nor diminution. even under the circumstances now so different from those of 20 years ago.